今天呢，是我想知道的朋友们都了解，是我们秋季音乐现场。我依然叫它秋季，因为即将结束。我们下周三会是闭幕的音乐会。今天呢，我们刚才数了一下，是我们从8月16号进入以来的第10场音乐会，或者说音乐活动也可以。那么到了今天，大家跟随我们走过很多音乐会的朋友们，应该知道我们一直在做古典音乐史的一个梳理。 那么到了今天第10场的时候，已经要接近尾声的时候，我特别高兴，我们迎来了一群远道而来的朋友们。大家看到在台上就坐的艺术家，不完全是印度艺术家，也有我们中国的艺术家。那么大家也就知道了，这是一场跨越不同文化的一个音乐对话。我其实应该更多的应该叫它做一场文化对话。 那么，在这个地方，我们希望有越来越多的音乐家，不同类型的，古典的、现代的、世界音乐的来到这里，为我们揭开下一个篇章。那么，今天呢，我特别感谢我的合作伙伴陈韵，他是西天中谱的朋友，他们一直在做这个东方文化之间的传统与现代。 音乐和文化之间的一些比较和研究，所以今天才有了这样一场活动。那么接下来呢，我要给大家介绍的是Tejo， 他是香港岭南大学的文化教授，也是做多年印度和中国音乐文化比较和研究的一位非常严肃的学者。那今天他为我们带来的这一场音乐活动呢，我们对他表示欢迎，谢谢。 Teacher, would you like to introduce artists to all of us? Thank you.
Thank you to Genesis Workspace, to Heather, to July, who introduced us. For making this event possible. My name is Tejaswini Niranjana, and I am right now a professor in Hong Kong. Because I'm living in this part of the world now, I try to connect my different interests. I've come up with this project, which is called Saath Saath, Music Across the Waters. Saath Saath in Hindi means together, together. And the idea was to connect different traditions of music. Not in terms of, say, simply cultural exchange. I think we're all familiar with world music, with cultural exchange, where everything remains quite separate. Indian music remains separate, Chinese music remains separate, and people just come and show off their own traditions. We are trying to be more ambitious. We're trying to do something different. This is beyond cultural exchange. We are trying to make a connection with possibly older histories. We don't know what that history is. My friend Zhang says that they teach this history in the Conservatory of Music in Beijing or in Shanghai, and they talk about how in the Tang Dynasty there were many Indian musicians in the court of the emperor, and how the emperor decreed that the Indian melodic scale of the Raga Yaman should be the scale for Chinese music also. If you have more questions, you should ask Zhang about it in the discussion, but I don't know more than that. So yes, I don't know if there was or was not a connection in the historical past. But clearly today is almost like there's a wall between India and China, right? Apart from the firewall, there's also many other walls. And it's as though there's no dialogue or no connection possible. So in terms of trying to think about an older connection, we are in the present. We want to try and work towards a new connection. This is the whole idea of the project, that there are dialogues possible through modern singers. This is a dialogue happening in modernity. We don't know if it happened in the past. Maybe it did not happen. Maybe it did happen. That's not relevant. It is, we are trying here to have a conversation that cannot be had by the politicians, by the armies, by the corporate world. We don't know, right? But through cultural practice, we want to try and follow the practice and see what kind of new connection could possibly happen in this space. In doing so, we also want to create some new music that's not only Indian, not only Chinese. So I think the concept today is that we are going to start with the journeys of these people. So there will be brief solo performances by Zhang and by the three singers. I will just introduce them. The idea is to say this is what their own practice is, They're all highly trained classical musicians in their own tradition, and they will then embark on a journey towards Hong Kong, where we also have our collaborations, towards China. We were in Shanghai and Jinza last year, twice in Shanghai and today in Beijing. That what is the journey that they have to take in order to reach this place? Apart from the journey of the flight, it's a much more difficult journey to journey in music towards China. And I think that's what you will see today. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Zhang, a very well-known pipa player who has a long and illustrious career, although he looks so young, and is young. It's the same with all of them, I'm not going to say much more about it. I think many friends of Zhang are also here, so I think you know him much better than I do. Rutuja Lad is a singer of the Jaipur school or the Jaipur gharana of Indian North Indian classical music. She studied recently with Dondutai Kulkarni, a very famous singer of that school of music. And when she passed away at a very old age, she switched to Ashwini Bhide Deshpande, who's also a contemporary major exponent of that gharana. She's singing and working in Bombay city, Mumbai, in India. Bindhumalini Narayanaswamy was originally trained in South Indian music, which we call Carnatic music. She later also learned North Indian music, which she likes to sing. So her journey is doubly complicated. She has moved from South Indian music to North Indian music and now is moving into these Chinese speaking and Chinese singing spaces. Bindu is multi-talented. She has a degree in graphic design. She has a training in dance. She composes for films, like film music, and she sings classical music. Bindu lives in Bangalore. Omkar Havaldar, you can imagine how old he is. Not very old. But he has been learning since the age of 4, Indian, North Indian classical music, first with his father, and then Nagarajrao Havaldar, and then with a series of very illustrious gurus or teachers in India. So he has actually many, many years, nearly 3 decades of experience singing North Indian classical music. I also want to acknowledge here that he is my music teacher. So I learned to sing his music from him currently. Omkar is in Bangalore, in southern India. One interesting thing you might want to know is that Zhang came to India with his pipa. He had a concert in Bangalore and he took the opportunity to become the North Indian music disciple of Omkar. So he also sings North Indian music. And I think you will see many, many interesting crossovers already happening. And I think that you will begin to see what this experiment could possibly be in the future. Thank you all. I request my colleague Chenyun to say a few words in Mandarin.
致力于中印在现代性的这个印尼上进行当代的思想和艺术交流的这样一个计划。那我们从2年前开始呢，由泰铢老师策划和发起了这样的一个基于古典音乐、中印两国的古典音乐的年轻一代而开始的一个交流。那今天大家看到的呢，是一个这个交流在现阶段2年以来的成果。 所以它的这个形式呢，会是大家从我们的这个演出的这个顺序来追溯他们在这2年的过程当中，通过西天中途的这个项目，在萨特那个印地语的那个中文的意思就是在一起的意思，通过这个在一起的这个项目，以来他们的一个音乐上的历程。这个历程呢，就是一个他们从自己的训练出发，在一起的这个过程里面，通过 对方的一个音乐的一个理解和文化的实践来获得的这样的一个阶段性的成果，所以呢，我们非常高兴，这是我们这个项目第一次在北京出场。之前呢，我们在上海和在香港有过2年的那个不同的地方的讨论和演出和工作坊。 因为泰铢老师他是现在在香港岭南大学文化研究系里面任教，他是系主任，所以呢，他会带来比较不同于我们一般在一个狭义的古典音乐或者是现代音乐或者是一般意义上的文化交流而已的那样的一个视野进来。所以他刚才很重要的一点呢，就是 我们很重视的不只是我们各自的传统为核，我们也不把这样的一个项目看成是一般意义上的文化交流，因为一般意义上的文化交流它永远局限在各自的传统之中，你很难从传统中走出去并产生有想象力的合作，对彼此的那个激发。所以其实是在这样的一个意义上才做这样的一个文化的这样的一个音乐作为一个主要的载体的这样一个思想和艺术的一个项目。那简单介绍一下台上的几位，张丽丽她是可以说她是主要生活工作在上海的一位琵琶演奏家，然后她左边的这一位卢树甲，她是来自斋普尔传统，在北方印度斋普尔传统，她的老师也是非常重要的一位北印的斋普尔派的一个北印的演唱家，所以他师从了两位很重要的老师。那他的左手边的那个 Bindu， 他本身的学科训练，他的那个大学专业其实是设计，但是他同时也是从小就学习印度斯坦的音乐，同时他自己也做音乐剧方面的工作，所以他其实是一个跨越非常不同多的领域的一个年轻的歌唱家。他的左手边呢是 Omkar， 他是也是在平常在班加罗尔，他的父亲也是他们家族一直是一个演唱的世家，所以他先是从他父亲，然后又是从其他的老师来进行他的学习。所以他每一位呢其实来的语境也其实也有很细腻的差别。好，那我们今天的那个差不多，我不会做全场的翻译，因为那个有点可能有点啰嗦，但是在必要的时候如果大家有需要或者有需要我再来翻译一下。那我们基本还是以他们的一个演出作为一个主线。
Start the program today. They're not going to use microphones because a small groupAnd if it becomes difficult for you to hear, then we will use the microphones. I don't think they will require it. It sounds much better without the microphone. So we will begin with short solo performances by each of the musicians, starting with Zhang. First,
very thank you for coming today. And I finally can speak Chinese. It's a very good thing because I'm in Hong Kong.让我非常的不舒服的一点就是一群中国人非要听你讲英语，然后你刚才讲中文他回答你还是英语，这个让我实在是觉得很难受也不太舒服。然后呢回到北京咱就讲国语好吧。那个我觉得我今天呢是最主要是说很荣幸能够跟这三位都在合作。然后我想补充一点是中间这一位呢他其实从小学的是那个叫 Cantopop music， 就是南印度的音乐，因为印度音乐分南印度和北印度两大系统，这跟我们中国的很像，因为我们中国是56个民族群居的一个这样的一个国家，所以每个自己的一个民族总是有自己的一个民族特色的东西。那琵琶也是一样，我是上海人，所以我是从一位老师重音派上海重音岛的，然后呢它是非常非常柔美的，只有文曲，没有像十人版把我先讲这样的东西。然后呢我还是从了一位就是潮州的古筝老师，然后潮州的筝呢也是我们非物质文化遗传传承的一个东西。那我想做一个就是因为今天我们讲的是古典的传承到我们文化的跨界，那其实音乐是一种国际语言，但是你要懂对方语言才能够交流，不然是鸡同鸭讲，对吧？不是你把咖啡和茶倒在一起叫 coffee tea， 然后就叫 fusion， 那是 confusion， 那完全把别人弄糊涂了，对吧？所以我比较反对香港这种创新。然后我在香港跟一个国外的学者争论起来，他觉得台湾和香港做的音乐比我们要好要地道，我觉得香港和台湾是没有我们这个根的，因为根在哪里文化就在哪儿，根没有了哪里来的文化，所以他们根本就不懂得何来创新。然后呢我是觉得要尊重传统，因为就像你自己写了一篇文章或者说自己做了一个东西，然后别人乱改你的东西肯定是不愿意的，也肯定是不高兴的，所以我觉得尊重传统，因为传统就是应该来被继承的，但是你要懂得传统以后我希望能够有创新。然后这点在印度的音乐家上体现淋漓尽致，但在中国我觉得没有太多人去重视这件事儿。然后呢我想从南到北演奏三个小的片段，因为今天还最主要是讲的是印度音乐嘛，我们就不把琵琶给做成一个很大的一个东西。那我们先从南方来，那潮州 然后呢，我会用不同的三种弹的方法，大家能感受到不同地域我们中国的文化的一个多样性。好，我们先说潮州的。潮州我这个弹的叫重六调。重六调什么意思？它里面一般我们总认为中国音阶只有五声嘛，但是其实在唐代和汉朝的时候已经有七声了。唐朝时候挖掘出来一个编钟，其实是十二平重六的，其实很早以前我们中国已经用了。那在潮州来说呢，它把唐朝的文化传承得很好，然后它一直没有断层过，因为潮州有自己的字典，还有自己的文化语言系统，食物的一个系统。所以当演潮州音乐的时候呢，它里面有两个特殊的地方音高，一个是发，一个是 C， 这两个音呢是在任何音乐系统上都找不到的，包括印度音乐，印度音乐没有这样的。然后是微声发，它介于声发和还音发中间，然后还有一个是微降 C， 介于是降 C 和还原 C 中间。这个讲的有点复杂了，是什么意思？这个是钢琴上找不到的，就这么简单一句话。但是你把它弹准了，没有地方风格。弹的稍微不准才有地方风格，我们可以试一下，好吗？就这个音，它准的时候是这样的，然后它不准的时候呢，它就带有优异性。因为什么这样？这跟潮州语言有关系。潮州的语言呢，就是我觉得个人认为有点像越南和泰国话。就这有潮州的朋友吗？没有是吧？那我就班门弄斧了。我跟一个潮州的朋友学了一句，叫做爱莫卖莫莫地该地该龙来，讲什么呢？这个也好，那也好，该选哪一个呢？但是你去听，如果我把这个音弹准了，它就是没有潮州那个味道的。我们讲的就是跟做菜一样，它就没味道。好的，你看，特别直白。但是，一旦有你看，是吧？就是特别南方的一个婉约的。那我在讲，我用的一个右手的方法呢，叫龙眼。龙眼的声音是非常柔和，它声音偏厚偏暗。那我们再往这个北走一点点，就是到上海。上海呢，这崇明岛、无锡啊这一块，我们都是算一个体系的。那我弹一段陈随，那个陈随叫《汉宫秋月》。讲的是古代的这种宫女啊，她那种比较寂寞的一种悲惨的人生。因为古代的皇帝有好多好多个老婆嘛，对吧？一夫多妻制。那这讲的主人公是十六岁嫁进宫，那一生只见过皇帝一次，最后皇帝驾崩了，她被迫为尼，所以是非常非常比较悲凉的一个曲子。但是曲子的旋律又非常优美。那很多的西方的一些学作曲的，就是尤其是上海比较严重，他们比较看不起音乐。然后我是上海音乐学院的嘛，然后到现在为止，可能是因为习主席的关系，我们才有第一任做民乐的出身的这个背景的院长，之前全部是管弦系的或者是作曲的。然后呢，所以他们说到民乐的时候，一直说我们的乐思平乏。什么叫乐思平乏？就是说音很简单，没有内容，然后不像交响乐，它有丰富的那种积淀什么的。那小时候我可能是也不大懂吧，然后我就被他们带过去了。但后来到大了以后，我觉得他完全是不懂我们中国的一个音乐。那中国音乐很简单，但是靠什么？靠我们的这种左手的这种修饰。我们右手琵琶是代表是阳，左手代表是阴，阴阳结合生万物，这是我们中国传统的一个哲学思想。所以你看，阳是主动发声的，对吧？如果你不做修饰，它没有人味，对吧？就比如说我们随便弹一点，你看，就比如说挺好听，是吧？但是它没有中国的味道。对吧？这就有中国的味道了。所以你看左手的修饰是非常重要的。那左手是用来干嘛的？它用来表达内心的这种悲凉，内心的比如说古代女性的那种怎么讲，对自己的命运的不公，但它不能不出声。所以这个陈随讲的就是这个，还有琵琶，它能模仿各种打击乐。待会儿你们会听到我自己模仿敲木鱼的声音，因为这一段讲的是那个女生啊， 他早上去做早课，一边敲木鱼，就念着念着，其实他自己想到自己悲惨的一生。所以他木鱼呢是代表他在那念经的一个场景，非常有画面感。左手呢是代表他内心那种愤恨和怨恨和哀怨，就这种和无奈，大家可以理解。就是我们在无锡这边有一个专场，一年前的曲子。你说一千年前我们自己没有人给我伴奏，我自己给自己伴奏，但又那么蒙太奇，有这种电影的这种画面感等等。所以你跟我说中国音乐它土，然后它没有和声，那我是不能够同意的。因为1500年前，然后我们就有这样的东西嘛。然后到现在为止，我去了英国以后，别人才我觉得我才得到了尊重。然后在那个中国是没有，所以这比较可惜。还有最后呢，然后最后我要讲的就是一点点，然后就是那个到了北方，然后我也在北京学习过，然后跟着刘德海老师还有杨静老师两位学过，那霸王谢谢，就演一点点，那是我们的琵琶的舞曲系统。
Semi-classical. It's not from the concert tradition, but the musical theater tradition. Accompanying instruments with them, because today everything is on the iPad. So we're using the apps because we cannot afford to bring all the musicians.
Ah, 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 ah.
Thank you. Manarangalige
The last 2 years. In Hong Kong, we have a collaboration with a very, very famous writer of lyrics for Cantopop. Also, he writes in Mandarin, Chow Yu Fai, who might be familiar to some of you. What happened last year was that Chow Yu Fai sent a song that he wrote in 1997, the year of the handover of Hong Kong to China, the return of Hong Kong to China, and he had some meditation on what might happen after that, and he wanted to talk about what can also happen when the new century comes. But let us play again when the new century comes. These singers do not speak Cantonese, but they can sing Cantonese, as you will see now.
然后呢这三位呢今天会用广东话然后来演唱印度传统音乐因为他们就是蔡介教授一个非常好的朋友叫乔玉范不知道中文叫什么反正他们的广东话也不大会讲然后就是非常有名的一个词人然后呢他就给他的一首他的词然后呢让他们几个即兴唱后来没想到效果还挺惊人的后来就是专门为他们就是创作了这个词这回我们在香港就是为他们每一个人创作了一首词然后他们即兴创作
You will see three different versions of the same song in three different Indian ragas.
然后你将会看到就是同样的歌词有三个不同的版本，也就是他们三个不同传承的版本，也同一个歌词，但旋律和唱法，还有它表现的方法是完全不同的。
Get it home.
Performers in Shanghai, and they taught these singers a lyric from the Kunqu opera from medieval Chinese. Yes, and they have composed that to an Indian raga called Bhairavi, which has all the flat notes.
刚才就要说他们去年，然后在金泽跟了上海昆剧团的李安，然后呢，就李安教了他们一首琵琶记，琵琶记里面一个折子戏。 然后呢，折子戏里面那个歌词呢，就让他们作为就是教给他们，然后让他们用印度音乐的方式演绎一下。然后呢，对他们来说其实难度很大，因为就算我有时候也听不懂戏曲里面一些发音到底是什么，他们就更困难了，就一个一个字小小孩都记下来。所以呢，他们也会用这个印度的 raga 叫 Bhairavi，Bhairavi这个呢是全部是降音系统的，它都是黑键的，黑在黑钢琴黑键上形成了一个音阶。 然后呢？但是这也是印度非常流行的一个音阶，非常好听。然后呢，他们就配上昆曲的这个词来演绎一下。然后，对，大家欣赏。然后我也是昨天刚刚跟我的老师 Omkar， 然后学了这个 Bindhumalini， 然后呢，我可能会弹错啊，弹错你们也不知道，也无所谓。所以，好。
Thank you.
it's slightly different now. You're going to see a very short projection of our Kunqu colleague, Bian, who's a very famous performer, performing something, and then you will see the rendition that these people will do of the same song.
Sing and dance goes together. So Leon is going to present, aside from the sing, he's also to present some style dance gestures of Kunqu. That's it.
Just this morning, Zhang talked the words of a song to the Indian singers, and then I'm going to perform it in a pentatonic raga called Bhupali. There is a mistake in choosing the clip. What Leon just sang was, of course, the one they rendered in Rag Bhairavi. Apologies for that. But what they're going to sing now is also something they sang with the Kunqu performers. And this is based on a folk song that all of you here will know. program where we have two compositions for you. When Zhangi came to Bangalore to study Hindustani music with Omkar in June of this year, he said that he's very fond of the goddess Saraswati from Hindu mythology and wanted to learn the raga, which is called Saraswati. Saraswati is the goddess of learning, also of music. So this raga, Saraswati, will be presented to you through a traditional composition by all of them together.
然后我今年六月是太久教授资助我去印度跟乌卡老师学习，然后我就是佩拉纳克拉纳第七代第一个中国人在印度历史上就是传承这个流派的一个音乐。然后呢，我当时呢就是非常喜欢印度的一位神，在佛教里面也有叫萨拉斯瓦蒂，就是辩才天女。然后辩才天女是恒河之神，也是所有文化艺术科学舞蹈的这种他的一个还有语言的一个守护神。 所以她拿的呢也是琵琶，在中国的一个形象是拿琵琶，在印度的一个形象她拿的是维纳琴。然后呢，所以呢我一见这位女神的时候，我就觉得啊，真的是非常崇拜。然后呢，没想到就印度的一个传统的音阶里面，他们的 raga 有一个是专门是这个女神守护的，名字跟她是一模一样，叫 Saraswati。所以我就非常要求卡老师教我这一首，其他都不想，就想学这一首。 然后给他来说，出个难题。他5岁时候学的这个 raga， 到现在为止他都没有再怎么去复习过。因为他说他重新再去学了一遍。所以呢，我们今天就展示一个我最喜欢的一个就是印度的 raga， 也是最喜欢的一位神，就是辩才天女的 raga Saraswati。
Namostute Sharada Vidya Prade.
Item on the list for today's presentations is a composition by Zhang. He made this composition called Green Tara, based on a goddess in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, which he follows. He did not know Hindustani music at the time. But when we decided to work with the composition of Zhang's, we figured out that this composition, without his knowing it, was actually a combination of three different Indian ragas. So each one of the singers will present each one of the ragas. The ragas are Jog, Kalavati, and Gaud.
And this song is created before I was 一直想为魏德牧写一首这个梵语的歌，有一天我在街上走就写出了这个旋律，但其实呢，后来发现这个其实跟印度音乐挺像的，我也不知道为什么会写出这样的东西。然后呢，就是发现这个音阶呢其实是中国的雅乐，然后这个雁牙指这三个呢，可能大家不太知道，这个在唐朝是非常常用的。然后中国我们中国有一位能歌善舞的皇帝，大家都知道是谁。 然后呢，他把我们的雅乐原本的雅乐给替换掉了，用了印度的音阶。然后雁乐呢是表现阿拉伯和印度这种连就舞曲风格的东西，所以它有个降 C 会出现。然后我们的运用就是这个。然后，但是我后来发现，就是我创作完这个以后，他们到印度那边呢是通的，但是他们是有三支不同的 raga 组成的。我这个走法。 我们是按照西方音阶的走法走的，但是在他们这儿呢，就会变成三个 raga 融合的东西，所以正好呢，我们就是今天用这首我创作的一个曲子，然后跟他们有个交流，然后呢，他们会用 talana， 然后就是说我昨天还问了我的 Omkar 老师为什么用 talana， 它其实没有意思的。
There are no actual words in the composition, but this is a form called a talana, which in the old days, like 700 years ago, probably was Persian, because there was a lot of influence of Persian, West Asian music on what came to India. And today the words have lost their meaning, but they invoke that sound of several hundred years ago. So any composition made up of these seemingly meaningless words, which are probably derived from Persian, is called a tarana, which is what today, so a green tara is a green tarana.
因为就是我自己不是佛教的上师，所以我没有资格去教他们那个绿度母心咒，也不能教他梵语，就是我的老师跟我说的，我是没有不是出家人，我没有资格教这个东西。然后呢，就是他们对这个也是非常的严谨，所以呢，就为我这个歌创造了这个tarana。tarana是没有意思的本来，但是它可以表达好多好多种意思。因为就是说，不要被歌词来限制，就是他们印度音乐最重要的一个精神，就大家有即兴嘛，你可以把这tarana想成花，想成月亮。
Na 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 na
Questions to if you have any more, like you know, you want to know more about the collaboration, more about the kinds of music that have been presented here, please, we are happy to take questions. You can address them directly to whoever you want to address.
今天演出的环节大概就到此结束，然后呢，就是希望大家有个交流，然后你们有任何对他们的三位艺术家的这个问题都可以问。
不好意思，我可以问一个比较简单的问题，因为我不是并不是一个做音乐的，但是我想知道的是，就是印度音乐家他们在演奏的时候，就是坐着的，又不像西方的艺术家他们是站着的，因为这样是因为我听说站着是有益于更好的发音，所以我想知道他们这种表演的形式是不是有一些宗教的含义在里面。 So I can also speak in English. So when we appreciate a Western opera, for example, so they always stand upright to make it more convenient for them to lift their voice. However, when Indian artists, when you perform, I notice that you always sit on the mat. So I want to know if there is any religious connotation or other special meanings in the gesture or everything you want to tell us. Thank you. Of course, it's not a music question, but I just want to know why.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We do also, not in the traditional way, but we are okay to stand and also sing, but that's more when it's a performance, a theatrical performance. We sit and sing. For me, that grounds me more. It's to get that stability and sing from the stomach, from here to get the, or the diaphragm to keep more control over this. Sitting really helps in that.
Also, we use a four-stringed instrument while singing classical music. So that's a tanpura, and that can be only played while we sit down. It can't be played when we stand. So there's now we are, since we don't have the instrument, we are using the digital tanpura, which you can hear the drone sound. But we do have a string instrument, wherein, and as Bindu technically noted about the voice production, which also requires one to sit and sing. And in addition to that, the instrument which we use, it requires us to sit and perform.
Yeah, the musicians have spoken. I will give you the scholar's understanding of this practice. This is a modern practice. If you have studied how people used to sit before, maybe like 150 years ago, some people used to sit on their knees. There were different ways by which people tried out what kind of voice production would be enhanced, right? In the old days also, if you look at even the classical texts, you cannot separate out movement from singing. So dancing and singing are part of the same mode of, you know, presenting some thought to an audience. It's only in the last 200 years that these two things get separated. And especially for women, because whole questions of morality are attached to this. And a singer is seen as more classical when they separate out movement from you know, singing. So in the last 150 years, when women in particular sit down and sing, they're not seen then as dancers or entertainers, they're seen as concert performers. So this is the historical understanding of how this happened, the separation happened, right? It's not about the occasion so much, but there are practical reasons why you do that today in the modern mode of voice production, because you need to also ground it, as Bindu said, and you need to hold the accompanying instrument. If you look at the old pictures, you will not see the accompanying instrument. You will see someone else playing some other instrument to accompany it. You will see them sitting differently, right? And the separation of sound from singing from dancing also happened very recently.
然后刚刚他有教授说，因为他们为什么坐着呢？就是因为他们印度的一个传统的一个声乐的一个练习的方法，就是要拿一个乐器叫 timbre， 就我们刚刚这个听到汪汪汪这个声音，然后就是，然后因为大家很多都不是学音乐的嘛，我说太专业大家也听不懂，反正就这个声音大家就知道是什么了。然后他们就是这个乐器呢，一直发生一直会有两个音，就是 哆嗦哆就这样。 因为在印度音乐里面，哆嗦是不能动的，不能够升，也不能够降，然后就要保持所有它们音乐结构的稳定，像地基一样的，就跟其他音乐都不同。但是其他的音都可以动，都变成降的，然后只有一个音是升的，它们的系统是这样的。所以哆嗦这两个音是非常重要的，在印度音乐里面叫 Saba 这两个音是非常重要的。所以，然后刚才就教授说呢，为什么他们先坐着呢？就是以前他们的印度音乐就是载歌载舞也是在一起的。 然后就舞蹈、唱歌都分开的，他们都认为是音乐的一个种类。然后就是近200年以后，把舞蹈和音乐分开了。然后他们觉得不想再让你觉得这好像是一个，就娱乐性的一个东西，因为他们就把唱歌给分开了。他们坐的时候呢，就是因为要放那个乐器，所以要做人练。但坐的时候呢，就是说他们有这种盘坐的一个坐姿嘛，所以呢也有助于他们这个气息的一个锻炼。
<笑>因为我参加过一次咱们这个交流活动，了解了一下这个印度音乐哈，我有一个疑惑，就是我看他演奏之前，那个西塔琴还有维纳琴那次演奏都拿出来了哦，就是边伴奏边演唱，那么他在演奏之前他要调琴调很长时间，就是我就说他是不是这个琴特别复杂，为什么调音要调那么长时间？
So she had earlier her CPG some other Indian classical music pieces, and she wanted for Vina and Sita, the players basically tuning it for a long time. So she's asking if these two instruments are particularly complicated in its structure so that they have to work on that for very.
Even the tanpura that she mentioned also has to be tuned for a long time. One of them will explain why that happens. It's about tuning it to the voice. In Indian music, the voice is the dominant instrument.
And the four strings have to come into high precision of matching each other. So so they spend a lot of time to make sure everything is in high precision. And what invariably happens the minute it's kept on a stage or in an auditorium is that it reacts to temperature and again it fluctuates. And you spend more time.
So what's the material of these four strings?
It's different thickness of
copper, steel, brass, of different.
Oh, 所以这个我要完全调得非常准确，互相的关系。
我补充一点，就是我也学过一点吉他，吉他它和 Vina 它麻烦在哪里？不像我们就是四根主要的弦， 它有好多十二根、二十一根这个 supporting string， 然后就是说是辅助这个更明显，所以它每一个调不同，你知道吗？它重新调一遍，所以这时间非常非常长。然后你知道在半小时以内完成的，那都是大师了，一般都是调不准的，调不准的时候你弹出来的这个音都是花的，特别难听。对，大概是这样。
谢谢。首先非常感谢今天这个机会，能欣赏这么好的音乐，真听到一些新的东西。然后我本人是在这个音乐的行业里面做的，但是呢，我并不是一个艺术家或者演奏者的这个角色。但是我比较好奇的是，虽然我们今天这个重心是说我们古典或传统的这个艺术的这个形式怎么去做相互的这个理解跟融合，但是我自己好奇的是，其实我们现在所说的这些古典或者说传统的音乐，它可能在很久很久之前它就是我们的流行音乐那我的问题就是，包括我们现在可能在座很多人或者说我们年轻一代，我们在了解比如说印度音乐，或者说了解一些传统的音乐的形式是通过流行的文化来传播的，包括我们在看摔跤吧爸爸这些里面，我们也听到很好的歌舞，也听到了一些传统的印度的歌舞跟现代的一些音乐的形式的一些结合。所以我特别好奇，就是说可能从艺术家的角度跟学术的教授这样的一个角度，怎么去看待这个传承跟融合的问题。I can ask in English. So first of all, thank you very much for the opportunity to let us learn about this form of new music to us. I work in the music industry, but I'm not an artist or like I'm more focused. I would like to ask a question regarding culture. Because we understand that today's focus topic is traditional music, but maybe a long time ago, this form of music is actually the pop music back then. So I wonder, in the perspective of artistic and also in academic, how do you view the fusion between popular music and traditional music? Because nowadays in China's younger generations, they learn about Indian music from movies. So they know the bands, they know the new form of the fusion Indian like music. So just wondering like, how do you look at the possibility and also the future in terms of culture?
I think I'll just give you my brief explanation, but I think as practitioners, and in particular Bindu, who works with many genres, maybe she will have a comment to make from the artist's point of view. Again, like looking at it historically, I think your point is right, that something that today we call classical, we don't use the word traditional in the way that we use it in China, because here when you say classical, you mean Western classical, right? In India, when you say classical, you mean Indian classical music. There's not that much Western music in India, learned as Western music, although some of it comes into the films and so on, right? So even the what we present today as classical music, from the historian's point of view, is only about 150 years old. And it started to be called classical only after Indian independence in 1947. Because it is part of a debate in colonial society to argue against the missionaries and the colonizers, who part of the debate between the British colonizers and India, and part of the reason why they said Indians were being colonized is because they were barbaric, they had no culture. And so a lot of the people struggling for independence felt they had to answer those questions by saying, no, we have a classical music, no, we have our own tradition, no, we have our own culture, etc. Right? So it becomes caught in that they are saying no, you are saying yes. And because of that, in the early 20th century, when the independence struggle was very strong in India, the nationalists were also into music. They created this as the national tradition of India. Because there was no nation called India before this. The nation comes into being as an answer to the colonizer, right? The British in some ways create India, because there's only a continent before that, and there are many countries. And it's only 1947 they cut the country and make it into several pieces, so they become nation states. So the idea of the nation state is a new idea in the South Asian subcontinent, as it is in China as well. China is a new idea, right? It's probably 100 years old. So the idea of classical Indian music is tied to the emergence of this nation state, because they need then to support themselves ideologically by calling something their own classical music or their own traditional music. So I think it's too simple a distinction, popular and traditional, because again, from the analyst's point of view, popular music is not simply popular. Popular music is industrially produced, mass-produced music. If you think of Theodor Adorno and the Frankfurt School Marxists, they will talk a lot about this, right? That mass-produced music is popular. There's also folk music. Folk is also a category we borrow from the Europeans. The Europeans go on around studying various things and calling them folk. The people in Kunming, in the university in China, right? They are trained in America to recognize folk music. So folk becomes a category in the 20th century, all over the world. But what actually happens in terms of music is music, even the North Indian classical music that you heard today, which is today called classical music in India, draws its inspiration from many, many different sources. It draws its inspiration from saint poetry of 500 years ago, from Sufi music from West Asia. It draws it from the peasants and the tribals and all the people singing in the fields, work songs. So labor and the singing from the temples, the singing from the mosques, the singing from the emperor's courts, all of this come into this music. And it is what it is today because of all these many influences. So it's not easy to call it traditional or popular or anything like that. The same music, interestingly, because the musicians after 1850s lost their livelihood, they could not perform for the kings anymore. They came into the urban marketplace. They became entertainers and performers in that marketplace. They had to sell their music for a living. They did this by teaching, they did this by having concerts, they did this by performing on the stage for their theater. And later they started composing for the movies. From the 1930s onwards, when the silent film gave way to the talkie film, in from 1930, many of the famous concert performers and singers started composing for the cinema. And that's why if you look at the older songs from Bollywood cinema, which at that time I did not call it Bollywood, Hindi cinema, have a strong influence of raga music. It's only, I would say, in the last 20 years that is much more inflected with this sort of global kind of music. As we also get into the globalized age, I think that music also changes. I hope this gives you a picture. But I think for the artist it's a different kind of struggle to maintain it. And I think you must recognize what a difficult journey it is for these, like I said, again I want to say this, highly trained classical musicians. Because classical music is not simply a genre that they learn, it's also an ideology. It's also something they grow up in saying this is the best form of music and we do not sing anything else, right? So for them to be so, to risk something so much, I think is really, really amazing. And we must compliment them for having taken that very risky journey. So I want to applaud them for that first. From the point of view of an artist who also does film music, what are the challenges?
工作者的就是一个艺术的工作者，而且他是在不同领域工作的一个当事人来讲，那他首先想说这个我们现在在说一个流行音乐也好，或者是古典音乐也好，在这样分隔的时候要意识到这样的分隔是非常晚近的一个发生，而且它有一个非常大的民族国家建立也是反直斗争成立之后的一个民族心情在这个里面导致了这样的一个分成。那在这个只是比如说一两百年之前其实并没有这样的一个区分，而我们今天在说流行音乐的时候我们在说的是一个工业音乐。 也就是说它的政治经济的背景是这样子的一个东西，而不是只是说它是一个民间的或者是日常的这样的一个概念。而所谓的哪怕是民间音乐或者说民族音乐这样子的一个概念，或者说是民歌这样的系统，其实也是来自西方的一个系统。所以在我们自己认知自己的过程当中，也是在印度和中国这样的国家，它在 追求民族解放的时候，他才会去把自己原来的音乐变成是一种传统。在印度，他其实以前并不会把这些音乐、raga这些这个系统 称为是一个古典音乐，但是在他们今天，当你在印度说古典音乐这个词的时候，他们都知道在说的是印度古典音乐，但是这个词在中国的语境里面，可能我们认为默认的是西方古典音乐，那我们自己的我们是它另一个词叫民族音乐，那其实这但是不管你怎么去区分它，它都是跟这样的一个时代的背景，很晚近的时代背景是相关联的。那么对于他们这些年轻一代的这个音乐家来讲，他们要在这样一个很负担其实很重的一个传统之下，因为他被赋予了一个民族的一个荣誉的这样一个传统之下，要把这样的一个传统进行一个当代的重新的阐释或者说创作，这个压力其实是非常大的。所以他刚才说呢，这个掌声给他们呢，就是因为他们既要保证对传统的一个责任，同时又要在今天的语境里面让它继续发生意义。那现在他就是让那个冰露来讲一下他的一个当事人的一个观点。
Okay. You know, it's a very interesting question, and so it got me thinking. And India that way is an extremely interesting space to live in, and I'm lucky because it's so diverse. And I think another thing that's that starts coming into is the question of identity of each artist. That what defines the artist also starts playing in this whole, at least my journey of music. So like Teju had said that, you know, classical music is so codified and very intricately codified, and to just even master that, you can spend not just one life, many lives. And hence, to risk breaking that means it's there are a lot of questions that come up. So if I have to reflect back on your question from my angle, it's been a question of identity for me. So and because in there's what's popularly known as the mass music, the music that appeals to mass, invariably is film music. And then there is a trained ear that listens to classical music. It's an acquired training even as a listener to enjoy something like that. So, and there is of course folk music, which every state, every language, every region starts having a different flavor of its own. And for me, when I broke out of my Carnatic, my South Indian classical to do something else, I was like, oh, she's moved to something else. It's become a little adulterated here. But I'm not yet fully a Hindustani classical music because my musician, because I'm still training in that. Then I'm not yet fully formed in that. But when I go to the villages to sing the so-called city music that I carry because of my cultural identity, they say, "Acha," it's like they are from city. But when I sing probably a folk song in the city, they'll say it's a very stylized, not original folk style. So there's so many interesting conversations that start emerging, and added to that, there is film music. So, but film music, whatever said and done, becomes this very, very beautiful meeting point of all these inspirations that can get into blending into something which is palatable by one or not, or at least the maximum number of people in India. And added to it is there's also language. So there's a lot to traverse through, yet there's a constant trying to find your identity also through all this as a cultural milieu. And India now has taken, like she said, dance has also started taking its own shape, music, theater. But at one point all this, and even now, these three come together also as a composite unit, and that's what later got interpreted in films. So that music from that also moved on to the films, and film keeps drawing inspiration from everything that's around it all the time. And
maybe you should pause so Chen Yun can do summary translation.
你提到了这个电影对于我们理解印度音乐是一个很重要的媒介，事实上也确实是如此。前面讲到在过去的一两百年间出现了舞蹈这样的舞蹈和声音 vocal 的分离，像这样的分离呢，其实又在1930年代之后，随着有声电影的出现，这个又重新聚集在这个电影里面。事实上呢，在今天你要作为一个 对他来讲，他自己也比较谦虚，但是也可能是真实的情况，就是他这样一个年轻的一个古典音乐的一个学习者，他觉得他其实还不能称自己是一个比较适当的说自己已经掌握了古典音乐或者是他的这个流派，因为这可能需要，如果你有悟性，可能是一辈子，没有什么悟性是几辈子才能够达到。但是就在这个还没有抵达的这个路途上，你已经发现了你的这个声音带给不同的语境里面的人以不同的对于身份的一个投射。你在村子里唱，他们觉得你是一个来自城市的一个声音，你在城里上唱一点点民间的村子里的声音，他们就觉得哎，你这个好像不是那么正统，又是来自乡野。所以恰恰是电影里面的音乐，它在30年代刚开始有声电影的时候，它还是一个比较的从 raga 的那个比较严谨的系统里面，我们可以认为古典的音乐系统里面吸收。可是在过去的这些年的工业化以来，在印地语电影渐渐的被让大家认为就是宝莱坞电影的这过程里面，它成为了一个所有这些变动中的身份诉求和音乐挣扎的一个交汇点。所以恰恰是在电影里面，你能够看到最多的他们从各种可能性，从各种正在发生的那个动向当中捕捉到的文化成为音乐的这样的一种转化和聚焦。所以他就是说关于音乐的这个部分，他确实是这样认为。而且他你们在印度的所有的音乐当这个电影当中捕捉到和感受到的音乐，就反映了那个当下的，就是他的那个处境，就是他其实也正是在这样的一个非常复杂的这个语境里面仍然在工作，作为一个文化工作者。
So one two last points I want to say is that the training that one undergoes when you learn classical definitely helps in being able to grasp many other forms, because you're really trained to get into a lot of complexity. So I definitely feel my learning or my ability to pick up things has also come because of the strong foundation. But the second thing, as I was talking about identity, is that at least personally, because of an exposure to all this in my growing up days and what I have sought out, is that if there's I belong to no place or I belong to every place at the same time. So it's very interesting to be in that space.
那一方面，传统的这样比较严格的训练使得他有一个很好的基础来吸收其他的可能的那些音乐的元素和文化的信息。那另一方面呢，就是他也非常高兴自己处在这样一个时代当中，因为以他的成长来讲，他已经很难说自己在身份上或者认同上是固定在一个很安全的领域，因为所有的边界都在流动，所以他自己也认为自己适合在今天以这样的一个方式来工作，也是因为这个传统在他身上的一个基础。
我问题是这样，就是我们刚才在听三位艺术家演唱的时候呢，他那个伴奏啊，始终有一个长音在存在。我就想这个长音它是只是作为一种音高的一种提示吗？还是起到一种类似于西方音乐里边的一种和声的效果？这是我第一个问题。第二问题呢，就是三个艺术家在演唱的时候，我们感觉到他们之间的这种风格还是非常非常各具特色的。我不知道这个特色是因为他们即兴的方式不一样，还是说他们在比如说音乐的律制方面或者音阶方面可能会有一些细微的这种差别。最后一个小问题，就是那个印度的律制可能跟中国不太一样，我就想知道这个章老师在这个弹琵琶的时候给他们伴奏的时候，是否会在技术上或者在音乐上是否会遇到感觉好像不太适应的难以就说跟平常不太一样的地方，我想知道这样一个细节。
So
the first, in fact, the first question is about for the Indian singers, and the last one is for Zhang. So the first one is the function of this group. Is it only for you to locate your tone, or are there any other functions other than that? That's the first question. 第二个问题是什么？
第二个是那个。
Oh yeah, so you show different
dramatically different, quite dramatically different styles in your singing. So is it only about because you are from, so the reasons behind that you are so different to each other, basically? Your voice or your tradition or what?
So we are different because we are trained in different traditions. We are trained by different teachers. In different schools of music, what we call as gharanas. So even in gharanas, there are many, many different branches, sub-branches. So that's how each one of us, even though we belong, we are all musicians of Hindustani classical music, we are very different.
So,首先就是流派师承不同。 即便是一个大的流派下面，在一个地域上，它仍然有很多不同的传承和不同的小的流派分支。所以这个是首先的一个不同的原因。
So I just want to add to that that of course there are all these intricate differences and details because of histories of training also, like it goes back a really long way, and what has then become distinctive for each school of singing, but also then the subjectivity of the people who bring themselves into this music. So what they're expressing is their subjectivity through their classical training. So you can't ignore that. They don't sound different only because they're trained with different teachers. They are different people.
第二个就是说他们是不同的歌手，他们在歌唱的时候，他们主观的对于他们的师承的训练的表达是非常个人化的，所以这个是太主补充的一个原因。
Even though I've learned from a lot of my gurus, my teachers, I also bring in my element of artistry in my singing. So whatever I sing has also a bit of me in it. Yeah.
所以他就是也补充Tejaswini的那个观点。其实他也不是只有一个老师，他有好多的老师，他跟从他们学习不同的风格，然后他的主观的那个个体化的一个表现就会也很不一样。There
was another question about the function of the tanpura.
Yes.
He has answered.
It's a constant reference, which is very, very specific to Indian classical music.
Yeah.
There is no other form of music where you see a constant reference.
Not even in the music. 然后为什么它会有这个声音呢？我个人认为啊，你其实你不唱，它这个声音存在的时候就有一种影响的状态，让你放松。哪怕你不听的话，因为它今天是在他们音响去听到自己的。如果你把这个放大10倍，你坐在那个环境下，你那个律动震得你就是那种特别放松。然后就是什么都没有就会有这个。还有跟我刚讲过了，印度的律制跟我们有很大的不同。然后呢，它是抖擞永远不变。 所以这个东西永远存在在那儿，因为它所有的音都是降音系统，然后就是说 re 可以变成降 re， mi 可以变成降 mi， 然后 so 不能动，发 呢是不降的。我们如果西方里面说 发 一降变成 mi 了，它不是，它所以发是升发，但是你不能把它理解成 so 降 so， 绝对不可以。然后 la 是降拉 ，si 是降 si， 然后 do 不变。 所以哆嗦是一个地基，永远是不能动的，所以这个乐器就变成哆嗦哆嗦哆嗦哆嗦哆嗦，一直这样来回的，让他们就是说不会 auto tune， 就不会走音啊，不会干嘛的，也知道每个 raga 该怎么走。然后我在学的时候呢，我学琵琶也非常不容易，我就跳过这个了。我觉得这个更不容易，因为为什么？我刚开始在中国的时候，我打电话给印度领事馆，然后我跟台就讨论过这个问题，他们都不接电话，也不回 email 的。 那有一次遇到他们领事，有时候我还说，哎，你们有没有什么机会啊？然后这个我想学啊什么的，然后他们说啊有，然后就是也没有消息的。那我知道北京的大使馆有一年的这种印度音乐免费教的系统，但我后来一查也不对，他今年教 Tabla， 明年教 Sita， 后年要教什么，也不可能系统的往下学。然后我就有一次在演出的时候遇到一个算是家庭主妇吧，但她以前在宝莱坞工作，她是给宝莱坞配唱音乐的。然后呢，她的古典音乐学的不是特别好。 他教我的一些东西呢，我就学下来了。但他每次都搞不清楚拍子，一会儿说一拍，你唱，然后说二拍进，第三然后就，但每次都这样。然后我说你们这个印度乐家每次音乐都这样。他说对啊，就是这样的。然后我说我学不了，对不起，我说我学的太难了。我说后来遇到他们以后呢，我说他们说哎你怎么会那么多 raga？ 你干嘛不演啊？我说我不知道这拍哪个拍子进啊。然后我确认印度时候，首先我把我学过的东西重新教了5遍。后来我才发现说为什么他们三个风格会不同呢？ 就比如说唱同样的东西啊，我学了一首特别简单，叫《莫汉的巴德东》，这是我们 K 拉的克拉纳的传承。但我之前学的是另外一个克拉纳，我忘记名字了，它是叫《莫汉的巴德东》，萨巴迪苏勒的莫拉巴德，是不一样，它会跑到另外一个地方去了。然后包括他跟他两个人唱的时候，他们说：“哦，我是往上走，你是往下走的。”所以这就是他们整个传承风格的不同。然后而且我呢遇到琵琶上的最大一个问题是说，因为琵琶现在也是改良过，不是以前那种了，以前没有那么多品的。后来就是因为音乐学院的系统呢有两个好处，第一个是保存了所有的传承，我们不会说因为民间艺人不在了然后我们失传了。但最要命的一个是什么，他把我们民间的即兴给抹杀了，然后就一定要变成我们的律师要跟西方的一样，
是，
然后就变成了我们现在传统音乐也跟琵琶刚非常可怕，就变成了就像你学钢琴从贝尔汤普森599749，你知道就这种东西开始来了，然后就把民乐就很粗暴的把它变成什么一级二级三级十级的一个级别，变成级别以后你会发现三级的曲子其实很难弹，然后十级的曲子其实不如三级的，你知道吗，就会变成这样的，他们会认为慢的用少的就简单，然后快的然后你觉得是表现技术是容易的。然后我在学印度音乐最难的一点，我就是觉得，第一个他们的这些音和音之间的关系比较难找，就像我们说的这滑音，中国唱民歌有很多的腔嘛，所以我只能找共性。就我那昨天还在问他呢，我说你怎么就是每次唱出来的那个音会发生这种像一条蛇一样的绕来绕去的？然后他们其实在一个主音之前做了好多好多个装饰，做了好多个装饰。就比如说我刚刚演的这个一弹你就知道了。就比如说它其实是一个很如果你把它拆分出来它是一个很简单的一个系统，就比如说你看，对吧，然后但你加上滑音就不同了，都来了，对吧，所以我觉得有的时候觉得说是非常难的，但你听的时候就完全明白了，就完全明白是怎么回事。但是我现在就是我的品啊比较窄，然后第二个呢，中国人的音色啊，这个品啊是对非常有影响的，因为是竹子，中国人喜欢亮。然后你去听我们的竹笛和印度的竹笛啊，其实形制很像，但是它吹出来声音，中国的亮高优雅，但印度的就非常的冥想，它很低沉，它的声音就让人感觉很舒服很温暖，一点都不吵。然后就是中国笛子有吹得不太好，就容易炸，你知道吗？琵琶也是一样，所以竹子的反应是亮的，在印度的所有的东西都是暗的，但他们的余音要比我们长很多，而且他们是在余音上做变化的。中国也有，但是我们就是说做的少。然后，但是它sitar它一个品啊，它可以变出一个音阶，就弹一下，当当滴答答答滴当，再弹一下，当滴答答答滴答当，它在一个品上就可以演奏出一个音阶。所以琵琶是不可以，琵琶最多到三度，哆到哆来咪最多了，哆来咪发嗦是最多的。所以就我要通过好多的方法来修饰这个东西，但是就是味道不大对。就比如说，你看我如果说我能做到这个推拉音的情况下，就很像印度音乐，对吧？就很像。如果做不到的情况下，我就我只能这样了。所以这是我遇到最大的一个困难。然后呢，而且就是我每次学的时候呢，就特别麻烦的一点就是，我为什么要学声乐呢？第一个我喜欢唱，第二个呢，我虽然唱不好，但我喜欢唱。然后呢，第二个呢，我是觉得你让我去学 sitar， 其实是另外一个技术，虽然很像，我每天要练好多好多时间，但我的脑子已经是成熟的音乐人系统，我知道我想飞了，但我飞不起来，每天怎么着？滴答答答滴答答滴答答答滴答，我要死了，我觉得。所以呢，我觉得跟翁卡老师学唱的时候，我觉得大家都应该学唱。因为我觉得为什么中国人现在有个很大的问题，就以前我们的民间艺人是没谱子的，对吧，大家听的好听的歌为什么流行音乐大家喜欢，因为它简单，第二个大家都是模仿的，你不懂音乐的话你就哼哼我就会了，对吧，所以这就是为什么会流传起来，现在音乐学院就把它记谱了，记谱以后记得非常的非常的细，包括它的装饰音，那个就完全限制了就我们的一个想法，就唱的每个音都一样，而且不容许改，这个就限制了所有人去学音乐的一个兴趣。所以他们是什么没有谱子的，刚开始他说你在记什么呀，每天那么忙你干嘛，然后我说我把它记下来，不然我忘了呀，他说你叫爸爸叫妈妈的时候只会忘了，我说不会啊，他说音乐是一样，他你记在心里就不会忘了，你就模仿呗。而且我而且问了很多奇怪的问题，就像我们中国学声乐啊，从另外一个方向去想， 我看好的抖音上也有，你的内腔要打开，头腔要共鸣，胸腔共鸣什么，混合声是什么，讲得非常细致。哎，你乍听一听觉得这个理论是对的，后来你再去仔细去想想，民歌的完全不是这么唱的，他们有什么这样的运用吗？完全不是这样的，但他们声音也很痛，对吧？然后嗓子也不疼。然后我们这完全是从声乐的 方向过来的，就被殖民了，我觉得音乐被殖民了。然后他们这一个呢，他们这个呢，然后就完全没有，完全没有这样，他就说你深呼吸，自然的把它像叹气一样的叹出来，那就对了。如果说你的气不够，然后要慢慢要练，但你不要去唱得很响。然后我每次问他，你用的这是什么位置啊？你的喉头为什么是这样的呀？这个问题太奇怪了，我们从来没有人想过也讨论过这个问题。所以呢，我是觉得音乐还是跟本来有关系的，就本来你这个天性已经在了，因为音乐是表达人的一个情感的，不要把它搞复杂了。而且中国人我觉得玩音乐太严肃，就觉得每次我们都是挑毛病的，根本不是去看别人好的，因为同行是冤家，这中国人就换了。然后真的是我坐在那儿，我弹琵琶，我自己都有这个问题，我第一个就会听到呀，弹错了。结果就我被训练成我的下意识反应是这个，而且我去忽略了整个音乐的美，这是很要命的。但我去印度以后，完全没有这个包袱了，就变成我说我唱错了，他不对，他说你唱的是对的，因为你不能跟我一样，你如果跟我一样，你要学我是没有意义的。印度音乐的精神就是在即兴，同样的旋律，谁即兴的好听，谁就是大师。我希望我们。
谢谢老师，最后一个。
其实我的问题已经部分被老师解答了，就是我对他们那个滑音特别感兴趣。
那应该来学。
我能感受到他们就是在那个滑音的运用当中。有可能因为他们整个就是您提到那个 raga， 就是有很多半音，甚至就是有的是四分之音程，就是所以他们的音比好像我们在国内听到的很多甚至西方人他的音准我觉得是要好的，我自己的感受。就我就想知道他们那个滑音在唱法，就是他们在即兴的过程当中有没有就是比较固定的一些规则，比如就是在服从这个 raga 的范围里面，比如往上是翻一个小二度，往下是翻一个小三度，这样就还是他们纯粹是完全即兴的在做这是第一个问题。还有一个问题是，我就觉得这是挺好听的，然后想知道他们是与生俱来的，就是他们听这样的音乐就听得比较多，所以他们就能做出来，还是说他们也要经过一个比较系统的训练，就怎么做到的，就是可以，因为其实很难，就是你要那么快速的把音转来转去。
我觉得这问题我可以带他们回答一下，然后待会儿还再问他们一些意见。就是我觉得我作为外国人去印度音乐是非常困难的，第一点。第二点，我是从音乐学院毕业的，音乐学院就毕业就是我们练习唱练，当然对我学印度音乐非常有帮助。然后以前我们训练的时候就是说三十秒必须把这个都弄完，就是钢琴大三小三，然后小三什么全部要来一遍，错一个就零分。我小时候就这样。然后呢，还有双声部训练，就是和声上的。然后我们特别变态，然后就是这一边唱上，我知道唱上声部，弹低音声部，然后突然间老师说换，你得然后马上你左手要弹上声部，你要唱低音声部，唱错也就是零分。然后所以这个对我来说，我模仿的能力就非常快。第二个，你不是说滑音吗？滑音其实我就说中国音乐存在着微分音，印度音乐不存在微分音。你只要是微分音，他就说你是错的。你为什么听到像微分一样的东西呢？是因为它有一个很长的滑音，里面经过了一个音阶。那降咪和咪之间，它里面存在一个微分音，所以它滑下来的时候你听到了那个微分音。但是它一定要落在那个稳定的音上，是不容许动的。它一动你就错了。然后所以你刚刚还有一个问题问得非常好 ，raga， 然后是固定的音阶的一个曲式结构，它有散慢、中快、散 ，arab 就是我们的散板。就跟中国戏曲的一个结构是非常一致的，所以学西方音乐的人千万不要把什么奏鸣曲式啊，或者什么这种曲式结构来套中国的，是完全行不通的。然后，但是中国亚洲的阿拉伯、印度、中国都是一样的，散慢、中快、散，包括戏曲。那他们在即兴的时候呢 ，raga 每一支 raga 有自己的名字，有固定的时间的演出，有早上、傍晚、下午、午后。然后还有早晨，然后它每一支 raga 有自己的名字，自己的名字以后有它一个音阶，然后呢就是每一个音阶有固定的，你不能够乱来，就像我们和声小调，你把它变了就变成和声大调就不对了，然后所以你不能违反这个规则，然后不能违反这个规则下你做即兴。 你知道吗？所以我们刚刚那个 Sarah Saudi 是非常难的，因为它里面一个，比如说上行是 Do Re，
我还是弹的，
然后这上行它比较困难，它是这样的，然后它下行是。是这样的，所以你要跳开一个音。我有一次我弹的，我不小心，我就是变成你看，就比如说，就错了呀。它下行，它上行只能是拉哆，它下行，然后跳开音，所以你要在这个规则下做这个练习。所以你去想，然后他们那个我们刚刚说的是北印度的，南印度他是南印度的 ，Curated 的，他说我们问过他，我们俩在聊天。我说哎，那我们自己可以创作出一个拉格，他说不可能了。我说为什么呀？然后他说因为南方的印度的他们更难学，比北印度更难学，你知道吗？而且他们更保守，他们把人类所有想到过的音列的组合全部给完成了。咱们算了算，一共有好像有三万多个组合是不同的，就是上下音阶不同，上行这样，下行那样，又这样又那样，所以它的组合是完全不同的。我希望我能讲清楚。
So he is really interested in the mute, because with mute you have some oscillating notes. He really wants to know, understand, you have been trained to do the exactly same correct note that way. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.问到我们今天，是这样，我觉得今天特别感谢他们为我们带来这样一场有深度的一个交流会吧，一个分享会。说实在的，然后我也觉得观众们也很专业。对，我看好像有很多是第一次过来，然后欢迎你们常回来做客。重点也是欢迎你们常回来。那么，我觉得那个这几位艺术家非常年轻，我听说他们是90后。所以我觉得他们带给我们很多思考，说实在的，这个话题可以继续延伸下去哈。而且我们自己在做的时候，我们听他们这样梳理，我们自己在做的时候，我们的上一辈和我们现在年轻人是不是也在这么纯粹的在做一些事情，我们都可以延伸一下我们的思考。那么也特别感谢张毅，他有他在这个舞台上，相当于把我们的整个的理解都带入了另外一个层次，所以非常感谢。对，然后这个里面给我们带来很多新鲜的那个感受，我是第一次觉得印度古典音乐的那个频率好像跟身体的那个频率很搭，就觉得很舒服那种，哎，就很神奇的一种感觉，也是在现场第一次能够这么近距离的听到他们的音乐。 So my major point is it's really rare opportunity for us to be this close to your music. So it's a really a great chance. Thank you so much.
Thank you.